Hello and a warm welcome to another edition of To The Point. This week on the show, we have a very special guest, someone who's been a robust former spokesperson of the BJP and now in the current NDA government. He's a man who's wearing many hats, handling three portfolios of environment, information and broadcasting, and also the MOS berth for parliamentary affairs. I welcome Mr. Prakash Javadekar on To The Point.
Namaste. Yes.
Mr. Javadekar, let me begin by asking you on the recent battle of legacy, which is so-called the battle of legacy, which is ensuing between Congress and BJP on the 139th anniversary of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Narendra Modi ji made a very important point when he said that one cannot divide the legacy and history on the ideological front. But don't you think that the political class inadvertently does that? It divides the national icon.
No, actually, the nation is asking a question, why a person like, a leader like Sardar Patel was ignored for so many years. So that's what they are asking. And I think Narendra Modi ji has taken a right lead in projecting the ideals of Mahatma Gandhi, Sardar Patel, Lal Bahadur Shastri and many others, because they have contributed a lot to the country and their contributions were not given the due.
But sir, why many questions are being raised is that NDA chose 31st October as the day when...
No, it was Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel's birthday.
No, but...
We can't change the birthday.
Absolutely. But when UPA 1 and UPA 2 were at the helm of affairs, they celebrated as the day when Indira Gandhi was assassinated. It was a big day for them. And when NDA has come to power, suddenly we see that, is it not a tit for tat kind of a policy?
No. The common man in this country is asking, why such a unifier of the country? Can you imagine? Britishers did not only divided the country into two countries, into India and Pakistan. They gave practically a free blank check to the princely states, and they were 540 in numbers. Sardar Patel, by his tact, wisdom, and a mature leadership, has unified the country. No country has witnessed such kind of unification. So that due was not brought before the country, and therefore country is asking. So I'm not going into, it's not a BJP-Congress debate.
But analysts are reading it as if, you know, it's a well-calibrated strategy of the NDA government to wipe out the Nehru-Gandhi dynasty.
No. We are celebrating Nehru, the first prime minister, the birth anniversary, which comes on 14 November. Today is the meeting held by the prime minister.
Swachhata week is going to be celebrated.
Yeah, so in different formats, we'll be celebrating every time. But this is what Chacha Nehru was loved one. And he was our first prime minister, so we'll be doing it.
So you said that you are going to bring into limelight all those leaders who were relegated to oblivion. Are you also thinking of highlighting or maybe bringing in the mainstream leaders like Maulana Azad, Subhash Chandra Bose?
Let me tell you, we are not saying that we will be doing only that what the earlier governments have not done. But we will give correct space to all our great leaders.
But BJP, sir, wants to remember 14 November as a children's day, or are you going to give it another name or probably remember it as some other day? Are you also thinking of those,
those
lines?
No, the ministries are different. They are working on it. The HRD ministry, nodal ministry. What we are doing is, as you said, and Congress people are saying, this is absolutely wrong. They are saying that you are not showing anything about Nehru-Gandhi dynasty. But Nehru is Nehru, and we are showing him, he's the first prime minister.
So it continues to be celebrated as the Children's Day on 14 November, you mean?
Yeah, whatever it is, yes.
Okay. Okay, we'll leave the battle for legacy for some other day. So coming to the fact that the recently top posts have gone to the people who have come from the Vivekananda International Foundation, chairperson of Prasar Bharati, Mr. Surya Prakash. He's been a veteran journalist. He's been someone who's very closely associated with Vivekananda International Foundation. Is VIF becoming the new talent pool for BJP?
No, it is not for BJP. It's for country, A. Okay. And B, it is not one institute. It are many institutes. You will find out our many... See, the new chief economic advisor is not from Vivekananda Institute.
VIF is very closely related to RSS as well. So, and VIF does work on the policy related issues on the for the prosperity of the country. So, are we to understand that RSS will have a say in policy making as far as the NDA government is concerned?
Let me tell you again, we are stretching too far. Vivekananda Foundation is a very good organization, in a way a think tank like situation. And many countries have many kinds of think tank. And we welcome all kinds of think tanks who can contribute positively to the national mission which is led by Narendra Modi.
Don't you feel that when RSS has a say in policy making of the government, it also sends out a message that obviously it's RSS which is holding the reins of the party and the government?
No, absolutely wrong. RSS is the biggest organization in the world, you can say, which builds around basically the character building exercise.
So why I asked you that question was that recently we also saw ministers going and meeting the RSS leaders in Nagpur. You were also one of them.
No, but we meet many other organizations every day.
There's a meeting with RSS.
When we are meeting with the RSS affiliated organizations, means what? BMS is the biggest trade union of this country. Should not we meet it? Bharatiya Kisan Sangh is a very prominent Kisan organization. Can't we listen to them? We are listening to other Kisan organizations also. So we are listening to all. The same bread, we are listening to our brothers. We are colleagues.
But sir, there is a certain kind of a curtain which we always see as far as the relationship between BJP and RSS is concerned. Why is that curtain?
Let me tell you. Let me once again redefine you. Actually, our many leaders have redefined it or explained it earlier time many times. RSS is a thought. RSS is an organization which builds up people with tremendous energy into a good model patriotic worker.
But sir, do they intervene in the government decision making?
No, not at all.
That and is political maneuvering,
no,
they don't intervene.
They
in that.
Don't intervene in each other's organization also. Mm-hmm. RSS never tells ABVP to do this or that, or today you are organize this morcha, tomorrow this morcha. They don't tell them. They don't tell who will be the candidates. They don't interfere.
But whether it's a decision of the chief ministerial candidate?
Absolutely not. They are taken by BJP.
When you
should be the BMS office.
When you read the newspapers, the headlines say that.
That is why I tell you.
Fadnavis enjoys the support of the RSS.
No, but don't believe every time what newspaper prints.
Okay. Mr. Javadekar, let's now come back to the way the Prasar Bharati is moving. Recently, Modi ji had said that all the major announcements will be done through the public broadcaster. Is that the reason why we recently saw that there were a flurry of criticisms, around DD, and a lot of nitpicking was being done? Do you think that is the reason? Because now suddenly the focus is on the public broadcaster.
But that's a good focus the Prime Minister has given.
Right.
And we have... Right now also I had 2 hours long meeting, taking presentations on various technical possibilities, technical development, content development, human resources development, so that we get best talented people working for the public broadcast.
So far, India has been the only travesty, because even in organizations like BBC, they have not hired bureaucrats, but there you find professionals working. So are we to believe from what you're saying that now probably Doordarshan will be run by the professionals and you will do away with the bureaucratic system?
Yes, some are legacy issues where you don't, you can't do away with everybody. But we will have right input of good professionals in content creation, in production, in presentation and in marketing.
So you yourself have been a person who's associated very closely with the media. So don't you think that sometimes, bureaucracy tries to hamper the way the things, the professionals try and do things? Many times it has happened.
I think the new Prasar Bharati chairman is there. Right. There will be new board members in this week itself. And the Prasar Bharati board will start functioning vigorously. I think they will come up with new challenges, and tremendous opportunities are there.
Right.
See, I can do wonders. I can show on mobile TV without internet. That I can offer. Let me try and go ahead with what we are up to. There are tremendous technological capabilities. We have tremendous system also in place. There are good dedicated people and engineers also working. We have to re-motivate them and put it in a focused way so that the organization is geared up for taking it the best and making it the best tool to reach out to the people more effectively. And so All India Radio, we are very happy and fortunate that the Prime Minister has chosen All India Radio to broadcast Man Ki Baat. We are now laying our emphasis on FMization because the medium wave and short wave in cities, you don't listen it properly. People are not buying now radios.
But sir, is it so not a move to appease the smartphone users?
Unless
because
we bring
in for a simulcast.
Unless we, simulcast will do.
Right.
So you can listen radio on your mobile. Mm-hmm. That's the best medium to happen and we'll do it.
But sir, as far as this particular FMization is concerned, 1100 crore is the fund which you are looking at. And when in times of austerity, when the government is also talking about austerity, how feasible is that plan really when you
see,
roll it out?
See, I'm not going to give you all details. But whatever we will demand from the finance ministry.
But sir, as far as the channels are concerned, the various bouquet channels of Doordarshan are concerned, I was talking to a few filmmakers and they said that Doordarshan is the only rich resource where you have a rich pool of movies, the black and white and colored, which have exclusive rights. So don't you think that now time is ripe for Doordarshan to think of a movies channel as well? Maybe you could generate more revenue.
There are many suggestions. We are definitely starting DD Kisan for this term. But there is also ideas about DD Kids, DD Nature, DD, as you rightly said,
right.
DD Movies.
Right.
And we are combined DD News, Hindi and English both. We can think of it. That's a hybrid, I think, goes well also.
Okay.
So we will come out professionally.
When you talk about bringing in so many channels together, HR policy is one sticking issue which we see in Doordarshan. There are about 300 to 400 contractual employees. And over the years, I'm not talking about any particular government, but Prasar Bharati has not focused too much on the HR policies. We still have contractual employees who don't have leaves, they don't have maternity leaves.
No.
How is that HR policy going to be put in place?
See, legacy, we have got more than 30,000 employees.
Mm-hmm.
For any channel, average employee ratio for per channel is 200. We have a ratio of 2000. So that's my problem. So, but we'll sort it out. We will ensure employees that nobody is terminated, nobody's services and perks are affected adversely, but simultaneously, how their productive use can be achieved. That to that end, we have certain ideas that the moment they are clear and the moment that these final decisions are taken, we'll announce those.
Well, that's a good note to take the break. So let's take a break at this point in time. And after we come back, we talk to Mr. Javadekar as the Environment Minister. Back in a moment. Welcome back. You're watching To The Point with Union Minister, Mr. Prakash Javadekar. Mr. Javadekar, just ahead of the UN Climate Conference, which is going to be held in December, you've already sent out a very stern message to the rich nations that they should not only talk about the mitigation measures through emission cuts, but they should also take action as far as the financial support is concerned. Do you think that action plan is ready from your government?
Yes. We have action plan ready because the Prime Minister is the first Prime Minister who has written a book on climate change and has added climate change nomenclature to my ministry, which was only environment and forest. Now it is environment, forest and climate change. Second, the world will arrive at a new regime, probably, by December 2015 in Paris COP. But this year's Lima COP is a prelude to that. And before that also, there are many continuous negotiations will happen. So what we are saying is, on behalf of developing countries, that the main principles on which the international agreement of Kyoto was arrived and implemented till date should remain the same.
Over the years, sir, why is there a perception that India has failed to communicate its concerns? Are we going to see rhetoric or is it going to be some really hard talk
from Indian side? No, we are hard talk also and we are putting on the table new ideas. In Nairobi, I put up an idea of why you don't purchase the IPRs of critical technologies which can show the cleaner energy path. So instead of paying to the countries, paid to your own companies who are into research, India and many other countries.
But sir, you know, normally when we see the battle of words between the developing and the developed world, it's generally a lot of difference between the cup and the lips. And we've seen the obstinate nature of the developed nations. They say something and they do something else. So are we really going to see some hard posturing from the Indian side? Or is it going to be like in the past we've seen that, you know, India doesn't want to be seen as someone who's blocking the talks?
No, but we will not be blocking the talks. Mm-hmm. But we will facilitate the talks. At the same time, we'll make richer nations, developed nations, to understand their historical responsibility.
Right. So coming on to the GM trials now, what is really happening? After the genetic engineering appraisal committee came up with its views, we saw various flip-flops.
No, there are two things. Everybody is on board as far as the trials are concerned. Right. Means you can't allow commercialization of crops or crops per se on GM technology unless it is proved very safe. Yeah. It takes period of 10 years. So 10 years is a long window, but then you need to experiment and prove whether it is safe or unsafe. So those scientific evaluation, comprehensive scientific evaluation is the process. You can say anything. As far as the field trials are concerned, the issue is already in the Supreme Court.
There were reports coming in that, you know, the BJP government is treading very cautiously because RSS inherently is against the GM trials.
See, so nobody is against. RSS and other organizations, or very few few organizations outside, are on a different note. Otherwise, everybody wants that to be independently and scientifically reviewed. So on that, everybody is on the board. The issue is whether the actual field trials or open trials. Open trials are different, confined trials are different. So there are many terms are used. But unless we allow science to prove whether it is good or bad, whether it is feasible or not feasible, whether it is safe or unsafe, you can't take a final call. And that call has to be taken after 10 years.
Coming to the Maharashtra election verdict. Can I say that BJP is in a position where BJP ke dono haathon mein laddu hai? Shiv Sena on one side and NCP also on one side.
No. Let me tell you, BJP, people have given mandate to the BJP in Maharashtra, overwhelmingly. We are the single largest party and nearing the majority. We have already 123 which have won, and 10 or more MLAs are already with us. So we can run the government. Shiv Sena is our old ally for 25 years, actually,
but sir,
30
why
years.
Why do you see this, the initial arrogance coming down to a mild sobering and then now a complete surrender? What forced Shiv Sena's climb down? Because we saw it and it was all over the television and the news reports that Uddhav Thackeray will not attend the swearing in.
But he came.
But
yesterday
he came.
We discussed.
But that's what I'm asking. What forced Shiv Sena's clamp down?
Nini, I think the people have given mandate for change from the earlier regime, and for a good thing. And BJP Shiv Sena has been perceived as a natural coalition for over the years, and they wanted to remain.
Sir,
and therefore, actually, you know what we were demanding? 130.
Right.
We have won already 123. So whatever seats we were asking for, we had already won those many seats. So it was not, but now things have gone. Okay, one election we could not have.
No, but sir,
Mumbai,
is it not true? Sir,
even
is it not true?
In Mumbai 92 corporation election, we didn't have the understanding.
Right.
And so sometimes this happened, this time this happened. So now,
no, but sir, tell me honestly,
is the final thing,
right,
which ultimately everybody has to accept.
But Mr.
And
Javadekar,
Shiv Sena has also thought about it.
But Mr. Javadekar, tell us very honestly, is it not true that Shiv Sena had said that the moment the BJP declares its chief ministerial candidate, they will declare the leader of opposition? So BJP suddenly was afraid that, you know, they'll have to take the help of the NCP, which is a so-called nationally corrupt party. So which is why, you know, you tried and brought Shiv Sena on board.
No, actually,
I was speaking to, off the record, I was speaking to so many BJP leaders who said it, and you told me
no,
this.
But let me tell you, the Shiv Sena also is a party which is thinking, and there is a much discussion happening in their party also. And so I think yesterday everybody was there, Thackeray and Mrs. Thackeray, they're all MLAs, so they were there. So I think that was a good posture, good beginning. I think it will fructify at some time.
But so what is BJP's relationship with NCP is going to be now?
No, NCP, we exposed NCP to thin nail.
Okay.
Means not NCP, but the corruption.
Right.
Our fight is against corruption.
Right.
And therefore, but every party, as Modi ji said when he came to, that I have enough numbers to run the government. But to run the country, I will definitely seek cooperation of all. So that's the larger policy.
But is it not true, sir, that NCP was used as a bargaining chip, just to show Shiv Sena that look, we are the driver's seat?
This is the strength of the media to interpret, and I grant them.
Okay, I'm not going to ask you further on this. But sir, tell me, after the thumping victory of Maharashtra and Haryana, what is the message you're really sending out to the allies? That ekla chalo re, BJP is in a position to do an ekla chalo re.
We are saying that all allies, and our thing is NDA, and we are saying to allies that you are our partners. Let us be practical and go ahead.
No, but
so that's what we
let's
are
be
saying.
Practical. What does it mean? That BJP now is in a confident position. It can go alone in all the states?
No, we have never said this.
Okay.
Wherever
so, Ekla Chalore is not the new mantra for elections in the coming states?
No, Ekla Chalore is not our mantra. Our mantra is to give people a good governance with our friends.
Okay. So, tell me one thing. Recently, Congress has been saying, Digvijay Singh very recently mentioned that now it's time for Rahul Gandhi, so for Sonia Gandhi to make way for Rahul Gandhi. As a person who is in the government, who do you think is a better competitor for you, a political competitor, Rahul or Priyanka?
Congress is an old party, a big party, and we have said that we want to make Congress Mukta Bharat. It's not about one word Congress. About the virtues which it represented. Mm-hmm. Virtues means the corruption, bad governance, sycophancy, dynasty, all things together. Congress is now known for that. So we want Congress Mukta Bharat means free from these all characteristics.
Congress,
as far as Congress party is concerned, it is their prerogative to choose whoever leader they want to project. We have nothing to say on that.
So don't you think that this is a worrying trend where, obviously, the government has got a huge mandate, thumping victory NDA has got. But don't you see this is a worrying trend for a healthy democracy that there is almost no opposition?
No, I don't think there is not opposition. But how can I see people have not given them 55 seats which is required for LOP.
Right.
See, we were also once two members only in 1984, and there was no LOP in 52, 57, 62, 67, 71, then again in 80, 84. So, seven earlier occasions there was no LOP. Why this time only we are discussing? There is opposition, I think. We have so many parties and they are doing their bit. And we want all to do their bit because it's in the national interest ultimately.
Right. So, one last question before we wind up. Cabinet reshuffle is on the cards. And if given a choice, which is a portfolio you would which would you drop?
For me, I am the part of the Modi government. That is, we are part of the team which is dedicated to the nation building. And rapid progress. We don't think in small terms of which portfolio, what portfolio and what not.
So if I were to ask you, which portfolio is closer to your heart?
No. See, every portfolio, not mine only, everything is closer to me because I think and I've lived throughout my life for 40 years of after the bank employment that I lived every inch of me and every moment of the time. We lived for the country and we want country to be progressed rapidly. Whatever contribution we can make, we'll make, and whatever under whatever scheme the PM decides.
Okay. Well, as always, a pleasure, sir, having you on To The Point. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
So that's it on this episode of To The Point. See you next time with another personality. Goodbye and thanks for watching.